My name is Councillor Anita Leach and I'm the Chair of the Committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the tables here tonight are, to my immediate right is Councillor Solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people who you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. Now, I know this evening that we've got some multiple petitions, and I'm just wondering if everybody who has a qualifying petition is wanting to speak this evening. Could you just let me know if that's the case, or if you've got one representative to speak? So, have we just got one representative for each application now? Oh, okay, well when I come to it, when I come to each item, I'll ask the question again, okay? If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again, for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not return to take part in any further debate that might follow by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. We have quite a number of people here this evening for some of the applications, which are 4, 5, 6, 10 and 11. So I'm going to request the committee that we take the applications in that order and then revert back to 7. Is that okay with the committee? Okay. Thank you. Just saves members of the public having to stay around longer than they need to. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, then that matter will not be discussed this evening and will be discussed as a subsequent planning meeting. Okay? Members, can I have approval of the minutes on pages 1 to 8?
Yes, sir, thank you, Jerry.
Thank you. Are there any declarations of interest? Okay. Any requests for site visits? Thank you, David.
I'm not sure whether I'm the one who should be asking for this one, but I believe we should have a site visit for item 4, which is the Old Man Stanley and the Rugby Club. There's quite a lot of controversy surrounding that particular development, which I think can only be properly resolved if we have a site visit and take into account the physical features on the site.
Thank you, David.
Gian? Thank you, Chair. I'd like to request a site visit for agenda item 12, Filmdale Business Centre, on Wallasey Road in Liskell, to visit the site to see for ourselves some of the concerns that have been raised by quite a large petition for what seems to be a small petition.
Okay, thank you. Are there any others? Okay, so for the members of the public who are here for agenda item 4, the Old Anselmians Rugby Club. Before I do that, can I just ask members if we're happy to have those site visits?
Yes, thank you.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you. So for members of the public who are here for agenda item 4, Old Anselmians Rugby Club, and agenda item 12, Fort Dale Business Centre, 1 52 Wallsey Road. We won't be discussing those this evening, so if you want to leave now, please do so. Okay, so we're going to move now to agenda item 5, which is the Holy Presbyterian Church on Valley Road, which is pages 27 to 36 in your packs. Can I have a presentation, please?
Proposed extension will be built between 4.4 to 6 metres from this boundary. for the existence of approximately 21 metres between both windows and existing first floor windows on 24 Market Street, which are part of the garden lines. No off-street parking spaces provided, and this may result in additional off-street parking in the surrounding area. However, the site is considered to be within a highly sustainable location, and numerous services available in adjacent Oilhead Town Centre and close to the train station and vehicle bus routes. So in conclusion, the proposal retains a prominent church with significant heritage interest. The proposed extension will be in keeping with the existing church, whilst also appearing subordinate to it, who have a much smaller footprint than the building replaces. All separation distances with neighbouring properties are either met or in improvement on the existing situation, and the proposal will provide acceptable accommodation for future occupiers whilst making best use of the existing shares. The lack of any off-street parking is considered to be acceptable given a sustainable location, and the proposal is therefore recommended for approval. Thank you.
We do have a qualifying petition for this application. Would the applicant, the lead petition, like to come forward to speak on it? If you look at the bottom of your microphone, there's a small button there that you can press. Could I ask you to state your name and your address, and you have up to 5 minutes to speak. I will let you know when you've got 1 minute left. Okay, you might need to pull your microphone slightly closer to it, it does bend.
When you're ready. Press the button now.
Yep.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good evening, Madam Chairman and Councillors. My name is William Harrison and I have lived at 3 Valencia Road, Holyhead for the past 30 years. During that time, I consider myself fortunate to live in an area which contains such diversity of architectural design. And needless to say, the Welsh Presbyterian Church contributes to that variety and is a fine example of ecclesiastic architecture. With reference to the site visit recently, I was struck by the supreme sophistication of the interior architecture of the schoolroom. It was both elegant and elegant, being neither overstated nor understated. The attractive persona of the Gothic windows being reciprocated by the support of the vault ceiling. And this is under threat of demolition. How could they? In passing, I think it is worth mentioning that the church would have been built with the pennies and shillings of a largely working class community, and their accomplishment is testimony to their commitment and faith. However, the computer generated proposal presented here this evening shows minimal regard for the human condition and mental health. To attempt to compress 18 flats into this small area is nothing short of disgraceful, and I believe it is driven by a desire to extract maximum profit from the demise of the Presbyterian Church. It seems bizarre that this is being submitted against a background and crusade for better mental health treatment nationwide. In addition, we live in the worst period in the history of British architecture. This being another example of the damage and environmental injury that can be inflicted on a resident's habitat, not to mention the extra pollution and car parking problems which will be generated. Despite public concerns, the head of Environment and Regulation, Traffic and Transport Division declared that they had no objection. This is utterly ridiculous, given there's already a very congested situation at that end of Alderley Road, which will not be solved by the introduction of cycle racks. There's no provision for car parking. More flats means more cars, leading to further disruption and chaos in the road. It is untenable to assume that every flat owner will only own a bicycle. Imagine if every flat owned at least one car. There's 18 extra cars to be accommodated in a frontage space outside the church of maybe 15 to 20 yards. A section of the road is planners will find already has cars, nose to tail, much of the time. If any of those flats should have two cars, the situation becomes even more aggravated. And not to find, put to find a point on it, downright dangerous for the residents of Holyhead. The developers obviously already realise there is a significant problem with privacy regarding the rear of the properties at the back of the church, because they have already planned to install frosted glass in the windows overlooking these houses. And as far as I'm aware, there is no legislation to prevent people from standing on boxes or stools to gaze out of windows, in which case residents' privacy would be seriously compromised. In this regard, the application displays an insensitive absence of consideration for the quality of life of nearby residents. As for the Welsh Presbyterian Church, it is, to my mind, a work of art and should be viewed and respected as such. Never respect and outshines the public. 1 minute. Never respect and outshines the public works of art which have recently been installed at great expense and quality. The interior equally embodies good design, with an impressive feeling of spatial awareness captured within its structure. With your both comments in mind, I consider the application presented this evening to be invasive, injurious, and exploitative. In effect, it constitutes an assault on the architectural balance and integrity of the church, which has historical ties with the sea and Hoylet Lifeboat Station. In short, Madam Chairman, this whole episode is one of the worst examples of environmental aggravation this town has had to deal with. If you were to ask me what intrinsic value I place on the church, I would reply that it would be an honour and a privilege to be in the same room, breathe the same air as the architects who designed it, and the craftsmen who excelled at the work, In doing so, they created an alchemy and a chemistry which is still apparent today.
Will the applicants arrange an item in the order as well? Again, we come to 5 minutes.
Okay.
And if I can ask you to state your name and your address, we will let you know when there's a minute to go, and we will stick to the 5 minutes. Okay,
thank you. My name is Matthew Myers. I'm the agent for the applicants of LHG Projects Limited. Don't want to spend too much time going over what the employee officer has said. Just to reiterate though, we've been working on the proposal with the council now for over 2 years, since April 2015, when the original pre-application was submitted to the council. Initially, the scheme was for replacement of the church and 6 new dwellings, which was refused. We were initially very disappointed by this, but having taken on board the strong feelings within the community to retain the church, we chose not to take the decision to appeal and work with the council. This has allowed us to produce a scheme which is both economically viable for the capital for the developer, and will also retain a landmark building within the centre of Hoy Lake. The new proposal provides much needed affordable accommodation for first time buyers within the area. I hope you agree this is a fantastic opportunity to bring the building back into use and support the council's decision to approve the scheme. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there a board council would like to speak and then would you like to come forward?
Yes, I'm the council chair of this for the Hoylet and Mills Ward. First thing I'd like to say that I think the council officers and the developers have made a really good effort to do something about the rejection of their previous plan, which was to knock the church down and build some property. And that's very good. But unfortunately, they haven't gone far enough. And or either that or they're just a bit greedy by trying to carry an 18 class. very much regret having to object to this plan, because the main effort, because it's a town centre site, which is a very valuable development area, and is obviously crying out to be developed in some way or other. But the church is there, and as the previous, as the objector has made, it's a very elegant, beautiful building, and we would like to keep it. And it's good that they intend to keep it. But the simple matter is, we couldn't cope with 18 flats in that area. I was so pleased that the committee came the other day on the site visit, and you saw how crammed over it was, and the cars all over the place, like a pendulum car park, only like that, like a day ago. It is unfortunate that the Sainsbury's shop is just a few yards away from it, and people are coming in and out of Sainsbury's all the time, and that makes it even worse. The houses are very close, the nearby houses are very close to it. And there's a particular plea on behalf of Mr. and Mrs. Stowe, who live right next to the church. We came into the courtyard. And the beautiful stone wall, which I think would be knocked down or covered in some way. And they'd have instead three flats looking straight into their garden. Now, you've come up with a good idea of saying, well, let's put the frosted glass in the bottom windows. Well, as the speaker just said, how long is that frosted glass going to stay there? Then people could decide to take that glass out, and I can't see any reason, maybe an officer later can tell me if there is a way in which he could stop taking that glass out. But the Stowe family are confronted with, you know, great big massive block of flats right in front of their room and their garden. I think that's a very poor show. I think we should try to help them and not have this developed. The main problem, my main objection, is the traffic. There's so much traffic there. The thought of 18 other flats, it's just mind-boggling. 18 extra flats. I know that there's government and people say you should try to manage without cars, and there's a railway nearby and a bus nearby. No. But then that was not people having the pleasure of their own family car. And we're going to have a minimum of 18 cars arriving in that road, which is already totally blocked. And then they're really going to go. Why didn't this developer go a bit further than he has gone? Why didn't he say, okay, yes, we'll build in the church area, which is lovely, I congratulate them on that. But why don't we have a sensible number and have enough room for some car parking? Because no space for any cars. 18 flats, lots of cars where they say they will or they won't, but they will be in there. Why don't we come back with a plan for 8 flats or 10 flats and some parking space and a bit more room around? Now, they'll probably say, well, that's not economical for us to build like that. Well, they just have to work their way around that. They have to find some way of making it economical and having a limited number of flats. So that's it, my objection. We have got far too many car flats for that space. We've got already greatly crammed area with too many cars there at the moment, can't do about it. Many people say we wish you could get rid of Sainsbury's, but you're not going to get rid of Sainsbury's. Not that I would want you to. And we're stuck with what we've got. So, lovely church. Thank you very much to the developer for coming up with an idea to retain the outside of the church. But please, will you reject this plan and send away and ask them. I hope they'll come back with a more modest plan with less properties, more space for cars, more space for flats as well. And hopefully, at the end of the day, we'd all be happy. But as it is the moment, I'm asking you, please, committee, will you reject this plan as it stands? Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry.
I am concerned about parking generally and lack of car parking spaces. And I think what Jerry said, it might be a good idea to reduce some of the flats and allow for car parking spaces. And these are churches, it's not musical buildings, and it is a good idea to preserve them. The next time you know, it's not much nicer. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you, Aaron. Steve?
Yeah, it's a difficult application, is it not? But I did go on site visit, but I'm very familiar with the area and the same fees and the area around them. I think we have to look at it in the way we have dealt with other applications, although this is an application completely in its own right. It's a town centre or location, so therefore the car parking rules and regulations can and will be waived. We only recommend certain numbers of car parking spaces, and we have been here before. I remember one in my own ward, 10 apartments, not enough car parking spaces. We refused it, went to appeal, car parking thing was disregarded by the inspector. So I think we're going to have to be honest with ourselves and the public that car parking isn't the planned reason. The other thing is, as I understand, the churches, and again from past experience, the Church of England doesn't need any permission to demolish a church. They did one in my ward, St Mark's Church, in Slater Road, if you remember. Just demolished overnight without planning permission, the church can do that. This isn't a listed building, so as I understand, I'm not sure, and the officer might, if an application comes in for demolition, it would be very hard to refuse that, just pure demolition and nothing else associated with it. So, my view is that the developer, who sat on this asset for over 2 years, it would seem, has made a valid effort to try and provide something that the borough is aiming for, and that's for homes, flats of a decent standard, to get people on the property ladder in town centre locations, plus protecting greenbelts and all the other things that go with it. So, my view is that in the round, I would love to have the power in this committee to say, well, go away, come back next week with 10. Oh no, we don't like 10, come back next week with 8. It doesn't work that way, and that's not the way the plan. This is an application that is valid, has been through a long period of tests that would appear between the officer and the developer, and this seems like an application that I would probably, unless persuaded otherwise before the vote, be likely to approve given its location in the town centre.
Thank you,
Steve. Thank you, Chair. I think I've got to agree mainly with Steve. The church is not actually being knocked down. The main part of the tower is being kept. Am I correct in saying that? Yes, but the majority of it. My concern is, and it's one of those iffy situations, you look at the highway traffic implications, and as I said, they can't see a problem because there's a bus stop down the bottom of the road and there's a station around the corner, but there's going to be, it reminds them, 18 extra flats there, which are going to be 18 extra cars in that area. If I've been living in that area now for 30 odd years, and if there's ever going to be an accident, there will be an accident around the Holderby Road, especially because there's a delivery being made at Sainsbury's and so on. The church itself, in general, I can accept, and I can accept Steve's arguments over traffic, but I just can't understand how our traffic managers are turning around and saying they can't see a big problem with this. I can see a problem, but I don't know which way we go. Thank you.
Okay, before I bring any more members in, there's a couple of questions that have been asked of officers. One was by Jerry to talk about the frosted glass windows, the car parking restrictions, and then we've got a third question as well. So can we get those couple, please?
Thank you, Chair. Just briefly on the obscure glazing, there is a condition that states that it should be obscurely glazed. I'm not open up to a height of 1.7 metres or finished one level. The condition does say it shall be retained as such thereafter, and therefore, if they did try to change that, then we could take the force of action to stop it, basically.
Okay, so hopefully that
covers
your question. And then in terms of the car parking, we don't have restrictions on the numbers of car parking spaces we have to provide.
Yeah,
That's right, thank you through you, Chair. That's what the council stands for car parking SPV4 talks about parking in terms of maximums. Now, a town centre site such as this is a very sustainable location with close proximity to the local services and bus routes. It is acceptable to have less than the maximum amount. In this case and in other cases, we get applications coming where there is no parking provision. I don't think that I've ever said that I can't see a problem in that. What I do say is that I don't see any sustainable grounds to object, for me to object, that I could call an appeal. And so, hence, I have to object to the application.
Thank you. Thanks,
Chair. Like other members who visited the site on Tuesday, I was struck by the efforts that the applicant has gone to try and keep the facade of the church and to retain some of the current architectural value of the building. But at the same time, I think Mr. Harrison, who spoke earlier, and Councillor Ellis, some of the issues in the area, notably the property on Market Street, I think it was Mr. and Mrs. Stowe's property. Well, I was quite surprised when we went into the back of the property, onto her property, to see the close proximity of the proposed flats, and in terms of how they were going to hold over her property. I was struck by that because I thought, well, really, as I've said before on previous applications, we are here to try and make life better for people in the world and improve the quality of life for people. And looking at this application, I struggled to see how. Apart from the fact that the applicant has gone to great lengths, and they are to be applauded for the lengths they've gone to attain the building, I'm struggling to see how 18 flats at this particular site would make life better for that immediate community. Parking there is an issue already, as we've said. I think we are, I think government, council, whoever, is naive if we think that because it's a town centre location and it's near a bus route and a train station, therefore people will move there and either not buy a car or decide not to buy a car or to sell the car. I think that is naive. I think we all know that 18 properties there, a good number of those are going to have their own vehicles, and I can't see where they're going to park without causing major problems to the people living in that area.
Thank you. David?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Rather like Eddie, I've actually lived in the area for 60 years, so I've been beaten by two. Having said that, that area is scheduled for housing development. It's a town centre area that could easily be used for housing. I know that particular church, having gone to the one opposite across the room, which is virtually identical in design, was in fact designed by the same architect. But getting back to the reality of the situation as we have it at the moment, I went on the site visits and I was very impressed by the attempts that the developer has made to make use of an existing building, which is a building which is of value in Hoylake. There's no question about that. Nobody would like to see it demolished for no reason at all. But having said all those positive things, my own belief is that this is a vast overdevelopment of the site, trying to cram 18 apartments, flats, or whatever you want to call them, into that particular location is OTT as far as I'm concerned. I don't think it's an appropriate solution. It's something that I would certainly not be supporting, and I would can offer some reasons for refusal later on. But my other concern is over the parking situation. The board councillor, Gerry Ellis, and to some extent Eddie has mentioned about the parking. But I have to go along with what Steve Fowkes has said, that we've tried on a number of occasions recently to have applications turned down, and we have turned them down, on the grounds that parking was in some way inadequate or was exacerbated by the proposal that was being produced. And on each and every occasion, it's been overturned at appeal by the planning appeal people. So I think to follow that particular route as an attempt to try and turn this application down, being fully mindful of the valley is congested. I'm down there at least once a day. I try to park there. I even have a mobility scooter, which I have problems trying to park there on occasion. So, but that's not the point. Cars have a problem in that area. But as has been said by the traffic officer, I can't believe that we're going to be able to sustain a refusal on those grounds. Having said that, I was concerned also at the impact of the neighbours, the existing neighbours, particularly the lady whose yard that we went into the back garden, so-called, on Market Street, and this is going to have a detrimental definitely a detrimental impact on her amenity value and to date of life, date of existence, if you like. So, without further ado, unless anybody else wants to speak, Chair,
once we've actually heard the reasons, I'm going to go to the vote. Okay, so Stuart, you want to speak?
Yes, on two points. My initial concern when I looked at the plans, one of which is now on stream, is that in respect of at least two of the plots, or two of the flats, which were numbered 3 and 10 on the plans as I saw them, there was absolutely no windows, or there was a very narrow window to serve the whole of the flat. And for me, you know, having regard to the amenity, I think we talk about amenity, you know, a lot when we look at some of these applications. In regards to the amenity that the occupiers and future occupiers of those two plots, in particular, 3 and 10, could enjoy occupying that flat, it just struck me that it's just not there. There's no natural light at all. The window, looking at that plan, about halfway up on the left is one of the units in question. On the left of the of that flat, as we look at it, there's a number of small openings for windows that serve a small room there. But the lounge room only has the one window in that short space of a short piece of wall at the top of the of the church before the new extension. That almost tells you that there is a degree of overdevelopment going on. The squeezing in of 18 means that to put a flat in that position, you're not going to get any sort of outlook for the occupiers and those flats and any sort of natural light. So that was my concern, that there is a degree of overdevelopment in squeezing those flats in. Just turning to the question of car parking, which has been raised. Well, it wasn't my initial concern, mainly for the reasons that Steve has outlined. I've seen the disappointment by inspectors' decision to inspect certainly the Royal Court Village, which had followed. I mean, on the grounds that each application should be looked at on its own merits, that you could say this is twice the size of the Court Village one. I'm interested always when we're advised on SPD 4 and the parking standards, the talk about minimum. There's SPD 4. There's pages and pages of it. Slightly more in SPD 4 than just minimum parking standards. When we had a lab some years ago, 2004, we had a lab about whether we could rely on parking to refuse a flatted application in Brighton. We know what parking is like in Brighton. Unknowing until we couldn't possibly do that. However, when we subsequently had meetings with officers, we were briefed as follows. Paragraph 4.7 of SPD 4 states that when applying the standard, it must be demonstrated that there will be no overspill parking that would have an adverse impact on the safety or amenity of existing residents and other occupiers. Now that's the sentence that was never brought to our attention when we talk about SPD 4. The other thing I'd say about SPD 4 is, it's SPD 4, 2007. That's the date, so it's a 10-year-old document, and it was born out of the regional spatial strategy, RPG 13, 2003. So when we talk about weight, you know, and very often people talk about what weight should we apply to these things, you begin to think a parking standard of 10 years old, born out of a regional spatial standard on development by government of over 10 years old. I'm beginning to think, what weight should I actually apply to this? Given that I'm not inclined to apply maybe the weight that the officers are applying, then I can only look at it in terms of the merits of the case, I would have thought. Now, all the colleagues have spoken about the potential overspill. Even if we go back to SPD 4, it does allow us to refer to that particular policy in terms of concerns that we might have about the impact on amenity of existing residents. And taking it as an application out of town, I'm not comparing it with the Port Village one, and I would be comfortable if one of the number of reasons for refusal also tested the applications of a potential future inspector on the grounds of parking provisions, because we'll only need them until we try. But my initial and key concern about the development is the amenity that occupiers of 7 plot 3 and plot 10 could expect to enjoy, and I would hope that when David returns with his reasons that would prove to be at least one of them. But I would have no objections in it also attempting to seek a refusal in addition to that by citing paragraph 4.7 of SPD 4.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. And I'd just like to make a few comments on this, having also been on the site visit. First of all, I'll speak up for people who don't own motor cars. There are plenty of them out there, especially people who want to have one bedroom flats and can't currently achieve that. I think, you know, the problems with parking, is worth saying, is not just the demand for parking, it's the failure of us as a borough and us as a country to provide good alternatives for people not to have to use a motor car and so on. So that's one point. A second point, I mean, Stuart's point is valid about the what he's raised about the light. What struck me beyond the site visit is that I think it'd be quite hard to come up with a scheme here that didn't present some kind of issues. If you're going to preserve the church, which I think is a great thing, we've got an empty building there, which is very attractive, and it's great we're going to preserve the main facade of it. I think you would struggle, no matter what you came up with, not to have some kind of amenity issues. And the last point I want to make is, you know, people say come in with a smaller application. I would just refer you to the middle of page 29, where the in terms of the affordable housing element, it says that the applicant has provided a financial viability assessment which demonstrates that the scheme would not be economically viable should this requirement be met. Now, that's to do with affordable housing, and you know, we're used to getting that kind of input from applicants. But I would just say that it does suggest to me that if we really expect the applicant to come in with a significantly reduced number of flats, I think there's a reasonable question mark then about the viability of the whole project. Now, when I look at the thing in the round, that it is a town centre location, that we are preserving an existing building, and we are providing a different sort of accommodation that doesn't exist to a huge extent in that area, then I think I'm happy to go with this application the way it is. I'll just make one comment to the applicants. Given the parking issues that have quite rightly been raised, it would have been nice if he could put some decent cycle storage facilities on the grounds. So could you please note the condition and make sure, if approved, that it's followed?
Okay, you'll take
passing the floor. Just quickly, Chair, if I can. I mean, I agree with the initial comments of the local ward councillors, and Jerry Ellis said, try and have to be developed. He does agree that it's a nice design, and it's great to retain it and be the actual church itself, because it does retain a prominent church with significant heritage interest, which is obviously identified in the neighbourhood plan. And when we look at, when we talk about design, I mean, I didn't agree with the petitioner when he tried the design.